Joining us for this meeting of the Naples Daily News editorial board is a council candidate for the new Village of Estero in District 5. It's Jim Bosch. Did I pronounce that correctly, Jim?
You're right on the ball, except I would like to tell you a little story so that everybody will understand what we're talking about. I come up from a family of seven, and I come from the city, grew up in the city of Hartford, and my father had a drugstore, and so our family, the seven kids, used to walk over to my father's drugstore to get ice cream or candy or stuff like that. And so pretty soon the neighbors, when they saw us, they would say, "Oh my gosh, here's another Bosch." So Bosch rhymes with gosh.
Gosh, okay. Bosch rhymes with gosh. Can you tell us a little bit about, for the first couple of minutes here, a little bit about your background?
Come from the city. I lived in the city of Wethersfield for about 40 years. During that time, I had my own business as a manufacturer's rep in the consumer electronic business. And at one point, I was asked to serve on the council. I reluctantly did. I was involved with a lot of sports programs. I coached football and basketball and baseball. But I did join the council, and that year, the council went from six of my own party to three of my own party. We were in the minority, and there were some good lessons to learn in that particular situation. And the one lesson I learned is people said, if you want to get elected, go out and knock on doors. And so that's what I did, and apparently nobody else did, because I got elected and three other people did not get elected at that time. I served 2 years on the council as councilperson. I served 2 years as deputy mayor, and then I served 4 years as the mayor of town of Wethersfield, which was incorporated in 1634.
And that's in Connecticut, right?
That's in Wethersfield, Connecticut. If there was a South Hartford, it would be Wethersfield. Okay. In that capacity, I also served, we had a regional council of government, not like a county government, but a pseudo-regional council government. And that government usually was responsible for the turnback funds from the federal government, five-year turnback funds, and was responsible for 29 towns, of which in that period of time, we were building a highway around from Wethersfield all the way around to Windsor, a highway, and it got turned down. And so the government gave this area $450 million turnback funds. And so I was responsible as transportation chairman to give that $450 million back to the different towns. And while you would think that would be a pleasant surprise, it wasn't so pleasant, because everybody thought they should have $450 million, which ultimately turned out to be $650 million. So that was probably one of the biggest challenges I had. I served on that council. I also served on the Greater Hartford Transit District as vice president along the way. And so I've got a lot of transportation and transit experience in my life in that background. The city of Hartford is where the legislative people will work out of, including the governor. And I was right next door, so it was easy for me to go in and do my lobbying for my town and so forth and so on, which was a little more pleasant for my town, because if we had specific needs, we had three major disasters in our town in my particular period of time, which normally a mayor has 25-year period of time before he has one. I started with an ice storm that shut the town for 7 to 14 days. And the next year we had a 100-year flood in our town. And then my final year we had a hurricane, Hurricane Gloria, in my town. And all three of those shut the town down for more than 7 days. And they were considered federal disasters, and so we had to go through that type of program too. So a lot of experience that are different than what other mayors normally have, but good for background and good for experience in terms of mayorship.
So you've got all that experience and you retire down here. Why do you want to come out of retirement and get involved with the village council?
That's a wonderful question. When I came down here, I was so involved, and my wife were so involved with the local and the state legislature, we decided we got to get away from that. So we came down here to retire. Mm-hmm. And then when I came down here, on my street, it's a brand new street when I came down there, there was 100 houses, and someone said to me, gee, you got to sit on the council here in the street, you know, because they need your experience. And so I said to my wife, well, gee, it's only 100 houses, it should be no problem doing this, you know. And then my resume got turned over to the Master Association, which was just turning over from a developer, which was 1,119 units. And my wife said, here we go again, you're going to get started in this all over again. And I said, Diane, there's 29 candidates. We've been only here for 60 days. How am I possibly going to get elected to the Master Board? So don't worry about that. Well, I got elected to the Master Board, and then the Master Board said, well, you're a former mayor, you should be able to put this thing all together. And so I became the first president of the Stony Brook community. And then in 2 years later, we started the CDD. And so they said, okay, you got that going. How about going over and working on the CDD? So right back to where we started from. So one of my friends talked to me one day, and he said, Jim, are you aware that Estero is a donor town? I said, donor town? How do you get donor towns? He said, well, you should look into it. It's a donor town. In Connecticut, the local communities raise all their money on property taxes. That's it. They get no state or federal funding. So it's a much different picture than down here in Florida. And when I looked into the situation in Florida, 40% of the tax only comes from property taxes. 60% comes from state contributing programs and so forth. And so I started looking into it and saying, wait a minute, how much money do we take in? And at that time, we were projecting that you would take in $10 million in the municipality of Estero. And it turned out that when I looked at it, my personal opinion, I couldn't see where we were getting more than $3 to $4 million services out of the county. Now, I'm sure the county would have a different story and will have a different story, but I said, gee, why aren't we investing this money in Estero? Why are we giving to everybody else? Subsequently, then I got involved in putting a feasibility study together. Some people had done some preliminary ones, and so we went back to that and started all over again. And then we projected in the feasibility study that we did and put together in 2007 that we would have anywhere from $15-$20 million surplus at the end of 5 years, which is in conjunction with the feasibility study that Joe Mazurkowitz put together. So we had been out since 2007. In 2010, we even went to the county commissioners and had a resolution and a vote on whether we should go up for a vote. And unfortunately, there were Bob James was very sick at that time, and so the point came down to a 2-2 vote, and then Brian said, well, if it's 2-2, I'm not going to vote for it. And so we would have lost anyhow, because on a 2-2 vote, it's a negative vote anyhow. But we did bring it up and had a resolution and everything brought to the council. At that time, we were going around making a lot of presentations, and people were asking some very serious questions, taxes, and how do you see this happening, and so on and so on. One day, Steve McIntosh came to our ECCL meeting, and I was sitting now on the board as transportation director, and he made the statement that, oh, by the way, we're going to be looking to annex Coconut Hyatt. And Don had come to a lot of the meetings previously and said, gee, I am in favor of incorporation, but not now. He didn't want it now. Mm-hmm. Don said at that meeting, we were sitting there, Steve, would you repeat what you just said? Steve said, yes, we're considering annexing Coconut Mall. He said, well, Steve, let me just tell you, you have just become Jim Bosch's best friend, because from this day on, I'm going to support incorporation of the city of Estero. And that's how this whole thing came forward. But we gave them our feasibility study. We gave them our charter. There's some differences. But why am I getting involved today? It's like birthing a baby, letting him grow to be 7 years old, and then my choice is either throw the baby out the window or try to make what I developed with my compatriots in this is, not just me. And I probably have the most experience and inside track to this whole thing, and so I want to keep it on the fact. The real key to this whole situation, this whole concept of light government, is first of all, I believe that light government is going to be the future of where we're going to go, not just municipalities, but all governments are going to have to face in the future, because so many are on the brink of bankruptcy, and everything else has got to be a different way. And I believe that once we get this all up and going, we'll have communities from all over the country coming in and visiting us and asking how they can bring this concept to them. And it all evolves around one thing. Our principal point is that we say and tell the people for 5 years in our feasibility study that we're going to have $3 million surplus a year minimum for 5 years. And so any council person sitting on this new council has to go by the Bible, feasibility study. And so in turn, I will remind if I sit on the council that every time we get off that $3 million area, we're going against what we told the people. And if we can come up with $15 million surplus in 5 years, then we're going to be doing something much different than what any other community has done. And I think it's very possible. We have a brand new infrastructure, so we don't have the big problems that they have in Bonita Springs with the infrastructure. And so it's a matter of keeping people focused. Now, I will tell you this, from my past experience in terms of being a mayor, someone who would not buy you a drink after hours and is the first person that will spend $1 million once they see a surplus in the budget. That is going to be the biggest danger. When people see a surplus, it's got to be spent. And if we can keep the people off of that point and onto the point that $3 million is what we promise the people surplus every single year, then we are going to be the shining star of all of Southwest Florida, and certainly showing people a new way to do government, and that is outsourcing. And outsourcing is only going to help putting more people to work. What we're talking about is we're eliminating two key points of killer budget items in a municipal budget, and that's pensions and payrolls.
So one of the things that you're not going to be able to outsource is a city manager. What are the characteristics you're looking for in a city manager?
Well, city managers are going to have to be familiar with county government here in this area, that's for sure, because we are going to be working with the county on several of the areas of outsourcing services. And so he's going to be familiar with that. He's going to have to be familiar work with county commissioners as well as a council. That's going to be much different, because many times there are going to be projects that we're going to be looking for more funds for from a county basis. And so it's going to be like a marriage between the two entities together. He should have a tremendous ability to be working with seven council people together. That is going to be essential. Because once he or she loses that, then you might as well say she might as well, or he might as well leave the city, because you got to have the confidence of the council if you're going to survive on as a village manager here.
So it sounds like you would be restricting yourself to Florida candidates for this job then?
To what?
Would you be restricting yourself to Florida candidates then?
I would be restricting myself to somebody who has many, has at least 10 or 12 years background in operating, because this new city is going to take an enormous amount of work to get done. I mentioned to Marianne before that when we start our first meeting, I would tell my fellow council people, if I'm elected, two words: don't panic. It will be just incomprehensible, all the work that has to be done. And it will probably take 2 years of every council person putting at least 20 to 30 hours a week. And it will take probably 4 years to get everything running properly smooth, in my opinion. But at the end of 2 years, I think we'll be able to see the light. And at the end of 4 years, we'll have a municipality the likes of no one here in Southwest Florida.
You mentioned you keep coming back there, mentioning the $15 million surplus after 5 years, I believe it was.
Yes.
What do you envision doing with that money? Say you pull it off and you're there. What would you do with that?
Well, I would say that should be a reserve. And what they do with it is, if you had a hurricane, there would be costs that are impossible to include in your budget. You'd be prepared to be undertaking a quick response to a hurricane with that funds. But what is wrong with having reserve funds? I mean, that's my question. You know, the process with government is today is you got to spend every single cent that comes in.
What would you anticipate the annual budget of the city to be?
Our budget should be between $5 and $6 million.
So you have three years budget in reserve, basically.
Yes.
Would it be prudent to lower taxes at that point?
I would suspect that would probably be one of the first things. At a very good point, people say to me, well, we're going to be raising taxes. I say to them, well, if you have a $3 million reserve, how can you see a council saying, I want to raise taxes? Is that raise taxes to have a higher reserve? So you can possibly see, more likely, they're going to say, if we have a reserve, then maybe we should be reducing the taxes in accordance with the amount of money that we're doing in the budget. So I would think that will be the natural response from my perspective in doing budgets, what's going to occur.
Lee County has been operating with reduced impact fees. The village will have an opportunity to go 100% on impact fees or set its own. Which do you see the village council doing, following the county's lead to reduce them or maximizing the income off it?
I would say I favor raising the impact fees up to the 100% level. We have so many new houses being built. On Corkscrew Road, there's been 3,000 houses, and we could not possibly do everything for the infrastructure necessary to accomplish those 3,000 houses unless we have impact fees. It would be impossible. And I think the county is now moving to 45, I hear. It could be higher. Just a short aside, we have a problem on Estero Parkway where, you know, where Walmart is being built on 41, and 40% of the streets on the road on Estero Parkway does not have sidewalks. So and there's a back entrance to Walmart off of Estero Parkway. So this would mean that we're going to have people walking and doing bicycling, doing golf cart entrance, and on 40% of the property they'll be in the road. And those cars go 60 miles an hour easy along that road, and you know it's a murder waiting to be happening. So we will be, our first project that I can foresee is going to be reconciling that. I went down to the county and appear before their sidewalk committee. If you don't know, they have a sidewalk committee. And we went to two or three meetings, and they did agree that this is a major problem, that we could reconcile it. So they put us on a priority one on the project. So I said to Dave Loveland, okay, Dave, well, gee, priority one, let's get it underway, see how we can get it going so we can do it in conjunction with Walmart opening. Let me get this straight. Priority one means you have to wait 5 years to get the sidewalks. I said, Dave, that's impossible. So he said, well, you know, we don't have the money here. Now, does it make sense that the sidewalks, for them to bring us up to date on sidewalks, we have to wait 5 years? And if they had just maybe another 10% in impact fees to cover those sidewalks, they could probably get them all done, you know? And let's go back to outsourcing. Instead of having the county do it, they could probably go out to people who are in this business and get them all done and put more people to work. You know, it seems to be a kind of simple, common sense solution. But obviously, we can't wait 5 years. So we're going to be strapped with a problem right off the bat. How are we going to resolve that? And so if we go back to our discussions about working with the county and the village and so forth, that's what this is all going to be about. And I think it's reconcilable. I think the county commissioners are all pretty fair. Mm-hmm. And I think they have the same situation as the council people have. And so, you know, I think it's going to be easy to accomplish. Yeah.
Sterile Council of Community Leaders is going to stay active. Do you see them having greater influence on the village council than any other group in town?
I see the Sterile Council people being a valuable asset to the city, because I should tell you that my four goals of this, which is important. First, we talked about the light government. Second, I think the only way we're going to make this a great city is have a lot of public involvement. And that means a lot of committees and a lot of asking a lot of people, come on, you got to join, we got to get them in and join. And so that's my second. My third thing is that we are immediately going to have to set up a zoning board or planning panel with legal status, because it will be essential that we get this done, because all the developers are running right now down to the county trying to get their deviations and so forth. And if we don't have something in place, then they're going to take the moratorium off of us. And so that'll be essential that we do it. And the fourth major thing is that I want to set up a working coalition, partnership, whatever you want to call it, with Florida Gulf Coast University. I see the young people there, I see the educational people there, I see such a great opportunity for them to be working. For instance, if you look at the IT program that we're going to set up, brand new. What a great experiment it would be for the students and the professor to come and join in there, bring their young ideas, Facebook and Twitter and all that stuff, as part of the municipal program that we have. And I don't mean just once it's done, leave. I mean, they're involved in it, and they're involved in political science people. Imagine if we have people that are interested in government, and they come in and they see there's a government that can have $15 million in surpluses. Now they want to be a town manager. They go out, who knows, Montana, they say, wait a minute, this can be done, and we can bring a new philosophy. And I did meet with President Bradshaw. I was up to one of our meet and greets, and he was there. And I mentioned that to him. He said, oh, are you kidding? There's so many problems that we can be involved in. He said, well, just call me. I want to get involved in this thing here as soon as you guys get a council. So I think that's will be a great asset. So to get back to your question that, you know, will the ECCL be a factor? Definitely. I think they'll pick up things like an environmental thing. You know, that'll be major to them. They'll pick up things that maybe the mining thing and so forth. But we certainly are going to go tap all the people that are involved in ECCL. Get involved in the town too, you know. So I think that they've done well since 2002. They certainly set the goals, and the goals are very high. And I think we should follow the goals that they set down. And I think they'll be involved in many different ways with getting the town to the point that we want to be the shining star.
25 minutes goes by real quickly. We've got a little over a minute left here in our time slot. Jim, what is it that you want to get across to the voters that we haven't covered here?
I think the most important thing is that in this new government, experience is going to be probably one of the most important elements, because there's so much to learn. And I would say that for somebody who has no experience with any type of government relationships, it's going to be a difficult start for them to go. Not that we shouldn't welcome everybody, but the first time we're going to need that experience. The most important thing I want to mention is that I would guess 80% of the people do not know they have 4 votes. There are 4 districts open. They have 4 votes, 1 for each district. And it's important for them to know that when they get their ballots, mail-in ballots, when they go to the poll, they're going to have 4 districts to vote for. Use your 4 votes.
All right. Thanks for joining us today, Jim.